This week I was thinking about the fact, about parenting and being a loving and doting father with my girls. And, you know, Blythe and Phoebe are my daughters, and they are in the family. They will always be in the family. Nothing will ever change that. I love them both, bless them both, although, you know, not always equally. Not always equally. They're different individuals and different times and different loves and different ways. They need special attention. But there will always be an open door for them in my home. No matter what, they are my daughters. They're in my family. And I'm sure you parents feel the same way about your children and your children's children and so on and so forth. And yet, I'm disappointed when they rebel. I get angry when they fight each other. Lindsay and I scold and punish them when they do wrong. And one of the ways we try to adjust their behavior is by withholding rewards if they disobey. Or if they obey, say, with a bad attitude, or at a later time, or only halfway obey. My heart soars when they do good, and I'm proud and joyous when they work hard and when they succeed, and we reward them with praise and tangible demonstrations of love. For example, like yours, I'm sure, those of you who have young kids, our refrigerator is absolutely blanketed with pictures and grades and all of those things. But then, of course, there's some pieces that get special attention. They get laminated for posterity because they're so special. They go into the Mosher Hall of Fame. And so I'm especially proud of those moments, and I want to reward my girls for those moments. Now, Lindsay and I try to be the best parents we can be, but we're finite and we're sinners. We blow it. There's fights that we don't see that we can judge accurately. There's arguments that we don't hear that we can't fairly adjudicate. And sometimes, try as we might, we just blow it as parents. But our Heavenly Father is the perfect parent to His children. And there's nothing that escapes His attention. And not only is He everywhere present, He sees into our hearts and knows our motivations. And a day is coming when Christ will justly judge and reward the children of God. Those of us who are believers, who are saved by faith, on our way to heaven, and have a home that He is preparing for us in heaven, and yet there is a judgment of works that we're going to talk about today. Look with me to 2 Corinthians chapter 5, just one verse for our opening verse, verse 10. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, and we've read this passage before previously, but we look down at verse 10. Paul writes, "For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each one may receive what is due for what he has done in the body, whether good or evil." Our main idea this morning is this: all believers will experience a judgment of works to determine their eternal rewards. All believers will experience a judgment of works to determine their eternal rewards. This is not a judgment regarding salvation, whether or not you're in the family of God, whether or not you're saved. That is the judgment of faith. We talked about that last week. This is about believers and how faithful they are in this life and what rewards will be promised them afterward. So let's pause and pray and ask God to open our hearts to what these scriptures that we're going to study mean and how we can apply them to our lives, be more faithful as followers of Jesus Christ. Heavenly Father, thank you for your goodness and grace and love through your Son, Jesus Christ, that saves us, that sets us free from the power of sin and darkness and the judgment we deserve and the hell that we deserve. Thank you for Jesus, who won the victory for us, who paid the penalty for us so that we can have that promise of eternal life. Now help us to understand the value and the importance of serving you in this life not only because we're thankful for what you've done, but also because of the promises you give in the scriptures that point to a time where you will reward your more faithful servants. Help us understand these passages. Open up our minds, and may everything I say today be true and accurate and motivational towards our faith, that we may grow and obey and love you more and more. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, let's talk about 2 Corinthians 5 for a moment. Paul is writing to the Corinthian church, and he's describing some details of life beyond the grave. And like I said, we've already read that passage in the sermon series previously. Verse 9 in that passage shows us that whether we are at home, which means at home in the body, physically alive, or away from the body, which means at home with the Lord, dwelling with Him in His presence, which means we're physically dead, he says, we make it our aim to please Him. And then we come to that passage. For we must all, and I think the inference there is mainly believers, although unbelievers will be judged for unrighteousness as well, and good things that they do. But he says, for we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that everyone, each one, may receive, that is, will receive, it's not a may as if maybe so, will receive what is due for what he has done, whether good or evil. This verse shows us that the choices we make today have consequences beyond this life. The choices that we make today have consequences beyond this life. That verse describes the judgment seat of Christ, and the Greek word there is bema, and it described the tribunal bench in the Roman court where the governor would sit and render judgments to the citizens. And that's the analogy that Paul uses for our judgment. Notice that it's Christ's seat. Like we saw last week, Christ is the judge. And clearly this is not a judgment regarding salvation, who will or will not go to heaven. But it is a judgment of works, according to what we have done. Today's choices have eternal consequences. Words we speak, decisions we make, things done or left undone. This is a judgment that will determine how faithfully we manage our time, our talents, and our treasures. We know that our daily decisions impact our own lives and immediately the lives of those around us. But the Word of God also teaches that our daily decisions, even secret, hidden things, good and bad, will follow us beyond the grave. Let's look at another passage. Flip back to 1 Corinthians chapter 11. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 11. And I'm going to read that one for us. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 11 through 15. Paul writes to the Corinthians again. He says, for no one can lay a foundation other than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Now, if anyone builds on the foundation with gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, straw, each one's work will become manifest, for the day will disclose it, because it will be revealed by fire, and the fire will test what sort of work each one has done. If the work that anyone has built on the foundation survives, he will receive a reward. If anyone's work is burned up, he will suffer loss, though he himself will be saved, but only as through fire. Here again, Paul is writing to the Corinthian church, a very carnal church at that time, and this specific context was their ungodly division of the church. And Paul gives them a warning. In verse 4 or verse 11, he says, there's only one foundation, and that's Jesus Christ, just like the hymn says. The church is one foundation. It's Jesus Christ, our Lord. But then he says, you need to be careful how you build on that foundation, how you serve, how you work in the kingdom of God. And this is not just for leaders, it's for everyone in the family of God, the kingdom of God. And verse 12 begs the question, really, what materials are you using to grow God's kingdom. What are you working with? Gold, silver, precious stones? Of course, those are valuable materials, enduring materials, materials that were used in Solomon's temple to build that temple. That's the analogy passed over to the New Testament. Or are you using wood, hay, and straw? That is cheap materials, non-enduring materials. So that we see in verse 13, each one's work will be made clear in eternity. Each one's work will be made clear in eternity. Each one's work will become manifest for the day, that is the day, capital D, the day, judgment day, will disclose it, manifest, become manifest, will disclose it, because it will be revealed by fire. That's the fire of judgment. And the fire will test what sort of work each one has done. Now notice that the subject is our works, not ourselves. The subject is works. The Roman Catholic Church has used this passage to support its teaching regarding purgatory, the idea that after you die, you can go to a realm and be punished somehow to work out the rest of your sins that you didn't take care of in this life. But the subject is clearly our works, not individuals. That's a bad application of this passage, a bad interpretation. Works that we do with true faith and obedience to the Lord will survive that fire of judgment. It's not a destroying fire, it's a judgmental fire. It's a refining fire, like we sang this morning. What happens when you send precious metals through that refiner's fire? They get refined. It becomes purified. The dross and the impurities come to the surface and they're filtered out by the smith. But what happens to wood, hay, and straw when it's put in the fire? They are destroyed, burnt up. So then, disobedience, faithlessness will bring a loss of reward. And that's what verse 14 and 15 teach. The precious stones, which represent our good works that are done in God's way with proper motivation, result in reward. But the burnt up stuff would be disobedience or obedience with the wrong attitude or the wrong motivation, will result in loss. Not a loss of life, but a loss of reward. Just like he who himself is saved, but only through fire. The image there is, say, a house fire. Just like a person escapes a house fire, their singed hair, they're smoking, they're coughing, and their clothes are all smoking and stuff, but they've escaped, they're free, they've made it out, but all their possessions are burnt up. Missouri Baptist Convention apologist Rob Phillip writes, like a purging fire, Christ's impartial evaluation of our lives burns away our worthless works and purifies our righteous works. So this is a refining fire. So like I've been saying, a person's salvation or acquittal is the term I used last week. Salvation or acquittal is based on his or her faith in Jesus Christ. But the experience of eternal life is not equal for everyone. Every believer will experience abundant joy and contentment and peace and satisfaction in God's presence. Yet, the Bible clearly and repeatedly shows that there will be greater rewards for those who are more faithful. And of course, some questions are worth asking. Perhaps you have some. These are some that I ask. For example, when does this judgment take place? Well, the Bible isn't specific. Obviously, sometime after our death. And some theologies try to nail down specifically when that judgment is. And it's usually according to the timetable of how they view what's called the millennium. We're talking about the theology of eschatology, which just means the end things. So the end things regarding an individual after an individual dies, or the end things revolving around everyone, corporate eschatology. And so as time moves on, individually and corporately, we're all moving to a conclusion And trying to identify where those two converge is tough sometimes. It makes sense to me that this judgment of believers would occur after the time of death, but somewhere around the resurrection time, not immediately after death. Because, at least in my mind, although time is fuzzy in eternity, a person's works need to have their lasting full effect before we can judge those things. Our influence outlasts our days and our months and our years. It's like tossing a stone into a lake. The ripples spread out until they're neutralized by other influences. Well, so do the decisions we make in life. We make decisions and there's long-lasting results. And it makes sense that for God to let those temporal results run their course for our benefit, not necessarily His, because He already knows, but to let those things run their course to the very end before finally judging our life. Well, another question. Well, won't everything have to be equal for us to be content and happy in heaven? Don't we all need to have the same thing? Won't there be jealousy and envy? The answer is no. Absolutely not. Inequality does not mean discontentment in heaven. Trust me. When God renders judgment, nobody's going to be able to accuse God of being unfair. God is just. All will be revealed. Nobody will be jealous in heaven. Between the just verdict of God and the removal of the sin nature, which takes away all those envious feelings and things like that, we will be 100% absolutely satisfied with God's judgment. Whether it's distribution of punishment for the wicked or rewards for the righteous. Well, another question. What kind of rewards are we talking about here? Well, like the song says, I can only imagine. However, the Bible does give us hints. For example, there are at least 5 different crowns mentioned in the Scriptures. There's a crown of righteousness in 2 Timothy 4, or living in faithful anticipation of Christ's return. Living in such a way that we are ready moment by moment. There's the incorruptible crown in 1 Corinthians 9 for perseverance through trials and difficulties. There's the crown of life in Revelation 2 for those who are martyred by their or for their faith. In 1 Thessalonians 2, there's a soul winner's crown of rejoicing. There's a crown of glory given to faithful pastor shepherds in 1 Peter 5. And are these all merely symbolic? Well, maybe, but maybe not. I mean, look at some of the details of the rewards that are listed in the 7 churches of Revelation. In the context of those, they're very specific. And a particularly interesting concept is the scriptural idea that after we die and are judged and are entered into the heavenly abode, that we will rule and reign with Christ in the world to come. For example, 2 Timothy 2, 11 and 12 says, the saying is trustworthy, for if we have died with Him, we will also live with Him. If we endure, we will also reign with Him. Revelation 22, 5 refers to God's servants. They will need no light or lamp or sun, for the Lord God will be their light, and they will reign forever and ever. Jesus promised the church Thyatira, the one who conquers and who keeps my works until the end, to him I will give authority over the nations. And there's several other passages that point to similar ideas. So in my mind, there's just too many specific promises of rewards for them to be symbolic or to be universally applied to all believers. God is just and good, and everyone will be satisfied no matter what reward they are giving. There's no whining in heaven, so you get it out of your system right now. Amen? So let's conclude with the relevance of the believer's judgment. Just a few points here, 6 points that help us really see the importance of this belief system, because I think it's not as popular nowadays. A healthy conviction of the reality of this judgment of a believer's works, number one, helps us stop doing wrong. It reminds us to stop doing wrong things. Romans 14, 12, each one of us will give an account of himself to God. I mean, if standing before Almighty God to give an account of your words, your deeds, if that doesn't sober you up a little bit, you need to reevaluate your Christianity. The Apostle John writes, "Abide in him, abide in Christ, so that when he appears, we may have confidence and not shrink from him in shame at his coming." When Christ comes back, we want to have confidence in his presence. There's an old parental saying, when you catch your child doing something wrong, is this what you want to be found doing when Christ comes back? And it's not just an act, it's really a lifestyle. Is this the way you want to be living when Jesus comes back? We want to be confident. Not that our works save us, because they don't. We're all saved by grace through faith. But when we live a godly, faithful life that pleases him, that's a life that's going to please God, honor God, glorify God. We don't want to disappoint God. He is our heavenly Father. Just like we want to please our earthly fathers, our earthly parents, we want to do the same for our heavenly parent. A healthy conviction, secondly, a healthy conviction of this reality, of this judgment, helps us keep doing right. Helps us keep doing right. Each one of us wants to hear the commendation of our Lord. "Well done, good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of your master." We want to hear those words from the parable. But notice I said, keep doing right. I mean, as Christians, by the Spirit, we should desire to do good. That should be naturally flowing out of our lives. But let's be honest, life happens. We invest in others, they let us down, we do our best to serve a church or a committee, and then somebody stomps on our toes or we get our feelings hurt. And the temptation is to withdraw, to stop doing good, to stop fighting the good fight. But hear these words, Galatians 6, 9 and 10. "And let us not grow weary of doing good." Let us not grow weary of doing good. "For in due season we will reap." That's a common analogy in Scripture. "If we do not give up, so then, as we have opportunity, let us do good to everyone, and especially to those of the household of faith." I've said it before that Christians who will make the most difference in this life do so because they are simply dogged and determined and stay at it day after day after day after day. It's not because they're dynamic. The dynamic preachers get the attention. The dynamic missionaries get a lot of press, but it's the day in and day out marathon of the Christian life that will determine much of our rewards. The convictional reminder of God's fair judgment helps us keep doing right things. A healthy conviction of the reality of this judgment also helps us to do the right things for the right reasons. For the right reasons. 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 5 says that when the Lord comes, he will bring to light the things now hidden in darkness and will disclose the purposes of the heart. Then each one will receive his commendation from God. This judgment of our works is more than what we do or what we leave undone. It's also about why we do it, our inner motivations. Because a person can do the right thing for the wrong reason, right? And even that, we can sometimes do the wrong thing for a right reason. And God will judge all that fairly and equally. In Matthew 6, Jesus teaches his disciples about genuine religion. And he's contrasting genuine religion with the Pharisees. Remember, he says, "Beware of practicing your righteousness before other people in order to be seen by them. For then you will have no reward from your Father in heaven." He says, don't be like the Pharisees, making their faces gloomy when they fast to prove the world how religious they are, sounding the trumpet when they give, letting everybody know how generous they are to the poor. It's all about receiving recognition for them. That was the motivation for them. And he says, they've already got their reward. Their reward was the recognition they got. See, the day of judgment will reveal our inner motivations and intentions. And maybe those folks that we thought were really super spiritual will find out that they were not so much spiritual. And those who we thought were less important in the church will have a greater reward. because of the heart. The judgment of believers motivates us to do the right things for the right reasons. Fourth, a healthy conviction of this doctrine helps us to be less judgmental about each other. Helps us to be less judgmental of each other. That context is Romans 14, another passage where that judgment seat of Christ phrase is used. And it's all about being gracious in our judgments of fellow believers. In those days, it was about eating meat sacrificed to idols and observing special days. Some people do, some people don't. You know, today it's other things. It's what music you listen to or what movies you listen to or whether you feel it's okay to drink a little champagne at a wedding or whether you think that's a horrible sin. Paul says, why do you pass judgment on your brother? Or you, why do you despise your brother? For we will all stand before the judgment seat of God, for it is written, as I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me and every tongue shall confess to God. So then each of us will give an account of himself to God. A healthy conviction of God's justice for all allows us to just let things go, to not be so uptight when another believer wrongs us, when somebody else says something that hurts our feeling or tears down somebody in the church. We know that there's a judge, so we don't have to be the judge. We trust that God's going to make things right, even for believers. And that sets us free to be less judgmental of each other, at least it should. A healthy conviction, furthermore, of this reality, of this judgment, helps us focus on eternity. Helps us focus on eternity. Jesus taught, don't lay up for yourselves treasures on earth where moth and rust destroy, where thieves break in and steal, but lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven where neither moth nor rust destroys, where thieves do not break in and steal. How do we do that? How do we lay up for ourselves treasure in heaven? By good works. Serving, loving, giving, all those things. Jesus said in Matthew 10:42, whoever gives one of these little ones, little believers, children of God, even a cup of cold water, because he is a disciple, truly I say to you, he will not lose his reward. By no means lose his reward. Same idea in 1 Timothy chapter 6, verses 18 and 19. He says the rich are to do good, to be rich in good works, to be generous and ready to share, thus storing up treasure for them as a good foundation for the future in heaven. And honestly, everyone in this room, we are rich. Throughout the history of the world and compared to the context of the whole world, we are all rich. We need to be rich in good works and radical generosity, knowing that God is preparing a reward, a heavenly treasure, for those who are rich in good works. That helps us focus on eternity. We are bombarded all the time to focus on the here and now, what gives us pleasure now, what enriches our lives now. But we need to look forward to the future. We have to have faith that that's going to be the way it is. Contrast to that, if everyone is treated equally in heaven, and there's no stages of reward in heaven, why serve faithfully now? Why contribute to the church? Well, sure, out of obligation or out of love or out of thanksgiving, but most of the motivations you find in the Bible are about eternal reward. That's basically the dilemma with socialism. Socialism doesn't work, even in the context of anticipating Christ's coming. If everybody's going to get the same, then why work now? Sixth and finally, a healthy conviction of the reality of this judgment helps us endure suffering and persecution. Helps us to endure suffering and persecution. Matthew 5, 11 and 12. Blessed are you when others revile you, persecute you, utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Jesus says, rejoice and be glad. For why? Your reward is great in heaven. Great in heaven. For so they persecuted the prophets who were before you. Great reward, not just average reward, great reward. Revelation 2:10, behold, talking to this church, the devil is about to throw some of you into prison that you may be tested, and for 10 days you will have tribulation. Be faithful unto death, and I will give you the crown of life. It seems logical to me that those who pay the ultimate sacrifice for their faith should have some special recognition in heaven. And wouldn't that give us added incentive to keep faithful through persecution? I think about my life, compare my life, and think about, say, a pastor in China who has to hide and meet in private, and always under constant pressure from the government, from the law, to be persecuted for their faith. But they're faithful, 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 and then they are martyred for their faith. They get killed for their faith. They're going to have the same reward for me who has it easy here in America? No way. No way. But God will be just and fair in his dealings. The same thing with suffering. 2 Corinthians 4:17. For this light momentary affliction is preparing for us an eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison. So that we can have assurance that not only there's going to be an end to whatever we're suffering, whether it's a physical or emotional thing, not only do we know there's going to be an end to the suffering, but also on the other side, God will reward us when we endure faithfully. Endure faithfully. One last analogy, we'll close with prayer. 1 Corinthians 3:8 says, each one will receive his wages according to his labor. As a teenager, I occasionally hauled hay in the summer for quick summer cash. And probably some of you did this. Now, you need to know, maybe I mentioned this before, I was a late bloomer. I was young for my age and underdeveloped, and I was a little guy in high school. But in this case, you know, it wasn't good for sports and even for some ways for school in general. But in this case, it helped out a lot. Because when we were hauling hay, I got to drive the truck. I got to drive the truck while all my bigger friends were sweating back there on the flatbed, tossing the 30-pound bales of hay and stacking bales of hay. Here I am riding in the cool air-conditioned cab drinking a cold pop. Now, when Farmer Bob started writing out the paychecks, mine was a little less. What's the deal, Bob? I mean, I worked the same hours as they did. Somebody's got to drive the truck, right? No, I didn't complain because I knew my work was a lot easier, far easier. And so I took my 20 bucks and skedaddled before everybody came chasing after me. I knew I wouldn't work nearly as hard as my bigger friends, and my wages were according to my labor. Well, the analogy eventually breaks down when it comes to eternal life, but the word is true. We will receive wages according to our labor. All believers will experience a judgment of works to determine their eternal reward or their lack thereof. We can trust in God's justice, his fairness in that judgment. Let's have a word of prayer and close. Heavenly Father, thank you.